Okay, and let me just see. Kevin, we're not seeing you, so I don't know if you've got your video on or not. I would ask that you mute yourself. I don't hear any background noise from anyone, so I guess everybody's got their system on mute, which is fine. But if you have a question, please do not hesitate to ask it. You know, there's a little icon there on the bottom of the screen that shows that you can raise your hand, and as well as, you know, don't hesitate to just sort of interrupt what I'm saying if you've got questions. That's one of the benefits of doing a live session, is that we can, you know, you can ask me questions if you have them as we go. Let's see. And Kevin, I am no longer seeing your video. Is that intentional or?
I have my video on, so I'm not sure.
Oh, there you are. You've just appeared, so I'm not sure what happened. Thank you.
Sure.
And is there anything I can do to help?
I'm not sure if the echo that you had talked about before is still present, but if I mute, I don't know if I go away or not.
Okay.
I can try.
Yes, last time you were still there but muted. Yeah, I still hear a little bit of an echo, so if you don't mind. But you're still here visually, so perfect. Okay, thank you. All right, if we were in a face-to-face classroom, this I would distribute the guidelines and we would go over them. And so I don't want to obviously take our time to read what you yourself can read, but what I do want to do is point out some things that I would go over in a face-to-face class. Now, I don't give a final exam in this course, because to me, this last research assignment, which is, you'll notice, worth 150 points, so it's the most heavily weighted assignment because it takes more time, more effort, more energy, more brain power, more space. I consider this the final assignment. I mean, I consider this like a final exam. It shows me everything that you've learned to this point about writing and what we've covered this semester, everything from how to have a clear thesis, how to stick to that thesis, how to connect your information in an organized manner, how to do research, how to do correct documentation for that research. So really, for me, this final assignment is what we've been building toward and shows me what you've learned this semester. I hope that kind of makes sense overall. So it is worth 150 points. Now, again, we have a target of words. Now, notice this is about double what we normally for the previous essays, not the little shorter writes. The previous essays, this is double the word requirement that we've had in the past. And so, again, you can fudge a little bit briefer, so down to, say, 1,100 words. Or a little bit longer. Let's just say if we expand that target range again, up to roughly 1750. What too much shorter than 1,100 words shows me that you haven't done enough research. So if you find that your word count is coming in a little kind of low, then it simply means you need more information or you need to expand a bit on your main points as you develop your argument. A little bit long or too much longer, and it means you're not controlling your research. You're not controlling your information. I had a student a few years ago who submitted a paper that was 1,347 words, and he basically just everything he found out he put in the paper. And so in that case, he was a writer who was not controlling his information. Okay. All right, point number two. Your topic needs to be debatable, but notice it doesn't have to be controversial, okay? Those are two different things. Controversial, you know, debatable simply means there's more than one way of looking at it. If the issue is already settled, then it's not debatable. Controversial is something a little bit more loaded, perhaps. It can be controversial, certainly. I'm not suggesting you shy away from controversial topics. I'm just simply saying that's not a requirement. Now, notice that the issue proposal, if you've looked over the information in the week 11 folder, the issue proposal is due as soon as possible. I recommended to students who emailed me that they wait until after this session to submit the issue proposal just to make sure they're on the right track. And I was very clear, and we're going to go over that in just a second, but I was very clear what I wanted in that issue proposal. And the point of that particular document is that it gets you, as the writer, to think through what you know about the issue, why you care about the issue, what you'd like to find out about the issue. So it is written in first person I, and it's just a document that kind of explores where you want to go. And I take a look at it, A, to make sure that you're on the right track, right? To make sure that you've selected a topic that is suitable for this assignment. And then to make some suggestions, if I can think of any, of where to find source material. So your issue needs to be approved before you begin. All right, and that's what I say here in red. All right. Now, I eliminated certain topics simply because, quite frankly, having taught research for more than 30 years, I'm tired of reading about these topics. It's nothing personal. It's not that they're really good topics. They aren't really good topics for argumentation, but a lot of times these are some of the ones that students think about immediately. Gun control, capital punishment, abortion, and animal testing. I've already had students ask me about the abortion topic. And while I know that people often feel very strongly about this issue on both sides, and it's one of the first that a lot of that's in the forefront of a lot of students' minds, honestly, I've been reading about this for so long that I really don't want to read the information. There's not a lot new, quite frankly, about that particular topic. So choose something else. Also, I'd like to suggest, I'm going to go over this in just a second, pick something that, yes, you care about, because I want you to find something that you care enough to do the research. But honestly, if you are too emotionally invested, there's a chance that the argumentation may not be that successful. Because remember that the argument has to do with logic, all right? More than anything else, it has to do with building a case as logically as possible. There is some room for, you know, emotional appeals, which we'll talk about in just a second, but mainly good argument is based on facts and statistics and eyewitness testimony and expert testimony and those kinds of things, when, you know, examples. Also, please remember, don't do research, don't submit something you've done for another class. All right. Now, minimum, you must use at least 5 separate sources for this paper. All right. It's possible, especially if they're good sources, that you can, you can just find 5 and that will be enough. Most students use more. But honestly, once again, it's just up to you and what you find in your research. I'm actually going to require that you do an annotated bibliography, which will be introduced next week when you actually begin the research process, that ensures that you have to look at a consult a minimum of 8 sources, even if you do not use them all, and that will be in next week's lesson. So I don't necessarily recommend that you begin doing your research until next week. I mean, you can do preliminary research, but realize you'll have to backtrack to create this document, the annotated bibliography. Okay. Also notice one of those sources may be field research, and I'm going to go over what that means in just a second. And remember about defining your terms. We've just spent a couple of weeks working on definition. So early in the research paper, you're going to want to define your terms. And more on this in a little bit. We're going to be using the same format as we've used all semester. Please notice you don't need a title page. We are not following the APA page formatting. We're using APA documentation format. There's actual a page formatting that the American Psychological Association uses. that contains a title page and then an abstract. It's like broken into sections. That's not the format that we're going to be using for this paper. We're using the same format we've used throughout the semester. Again, you need a relevant title. Remember that the term claim is in argumentation is simply means your thesis. This is what you, the idea that you want to support. And it mainly should be supported by logical appeals. If you looked over the PowerPoint that was in last week's folder that talked about argumentation, there are three types of what are called appeals. You can appeal to logic, which is to the brain, the head. You can appeal to emotions, which the heart, of course. And then ethical appeals, which probably has more to do with what we would think of as being our conscience or our sense of standards and right and wrong. Largely, you want to stick with logical appeals. It doesn't mean that you can't have the other two. It just means that you run into some risk here. For example, if to primarily inflame someone's emotions, that can be very powerful. It can also only, it's short-lived frequently. And also your audience can feel manipulated if indeed I like to think of that commercial with Sarah McLachlan singing in the background in the arms of an angel. And, that where with the animals that were abused in the end, the whole goal of that commercial was to have people send money, but I can't stand to watch it. So it kind of backfires with me. So, cause I'll turn it off as soon as I see it. And then ethical appeals only work if you and your audience are on the same page, right? If I'm not a particularly religious person and you are, and you try to make religious claims about something or vice versa, I'm a terribly religious person and you're not, you can see how we're not on that, we don't share common ground. So that will not work, okay? Now, as far as arrangement, in the week 13 folder, I'll have some information about how to put the paper together once you've found your research. And we'll probably have a very short little live session again that will discuss how to, how to craft your paper and go over what it sort of should look like and look at the documentation and so forth with the sample paper. Please remember, this is one of the things that we've been emphasizing this semester. You want to elevate your diction usage. Language usage to that mid-level, not too formal, not too casual. Most students err on the side of being too casual. So avoid, cliches, avoid abbreviation unless they're acronyms. We talked about that. You spell them out the first time. Avoid especially contractions, isn't what wasn't, couldn't, shouldn't, wouldn't, slang terms. Remember to evaluate your sources. I'm not requiring that you use the databases for this paper, although I'm going to show you how to successfully use, sort of expand your understanding of the GNTC databases just in a couple of minutes. But you may certainly use a popular search engine such as Google or Bing, but it's on you to make sure your information is reliable. Okay, that's a requirement for writing good research. All right, continuing. Of course, using APA formats, I still have a couple of students submitting work using Modern Language Association formatting. That is incorrect and you cannot pass. It's not that the formats are incorrect, you're not meeting this requirement, okay? So please realize, in the paper itself, you have to give credit to avoid, whether you're paraphrasing or directly quoting, you have to use in-text citation to correctly document. And at the end of the paper, you have to have a references page that contains all of the entries for each of the sources that you actually use in the paper. In week 13, we'll talk about fallacies, because at this point, you're going to be thinking about putting the paper itself together. Here, I've sort of repeated what I said before about standard American English. Right. Our process, again, the issue proposal is due by Monday, but I'm going to read them as soon as you submit them and give you feedback so that you can kind of think about getting started. I'll probably go ahead and open the week 12 folder early that contains the annotated bibliography assignment, because you want to do that at the same time that you're doing your research. So there's actually a recorded video that explains how to do the annotated bibliography. There's a sample annotated bibliography. And what the difference between an annotated bibliography and your references page, the annotated bibliography is considered a working document. So what it does is kind of document your research. Good researchers go far beyond what the basic minimum sources are required. Only beginning researchers that if an instructor says, okay, you need 5 sources, they stop at 5, okay? So what this working bibliography does is it documents your research process, and you kind of summarize the different articles that you read, even if you never use them all in a paper, okay? So again, here are our guidelines, here are the dates. Notice this will take us to the very end of the semester, because December 7th is the last day of classes at GNTC. So here's all of my info, here are all the dates, and I do have them on the calendar as well, should you have any questions. All right, so I'm going to pause there, and do you have anything you want to ask me at this point before we move on? Okay, then let's talk about field research. I had this PowerPoint in your folder, and I'm going to have to do some work because it doesn't meet the accessibility requirements. So I think because of the visuals, but field research is anything that you, the writer, the researcher, do yourself. And essentially, there are 3 main types: interviews, surveys, and direct observations. I am not requiring you to do field research, but please be aware it's an option if you want to. I mentioned, for example, if you have, if you're out of 5 sources, one of them can be a piece of field research. If you have more sources, you may do more field research. Does that make sense? I just don't want it to be unbalanced. The first type of field research is an interview. And it can be in person, or you can use email, or you can actually call someone. It's a bit more formal than a casual conversation. You normally arrange a person in advance. You have a list of questions. You conduct the interview. Then you look back at the information to see if any of it's useful. I can give you an example. I had a student who, he was a father. He had a 2-year-old daughter, and he interviewed his pediatrician because what he wanted to argue in his paper was that children under the age of, I think it was 3, should not, watch television. I mean, that was really what he wanted to argue. And so he came up with a list of questions, and he interviewed his pediatrician about the effects of excessive television watching on young children. And I received some interesting information, some of which supported what he wanted to say and some of which didn't. Anyway, and he used some of it in his paper. The second type of field research is an observation, and this is when you actually go and sit and observe. For example, if you intend to be an educator and you go to a 4-year institution, in order to get an education degree, one of the courses you take will be an observation course, where you literally sit in a classroom and take notes all day about what you observe. And then you write journals, and you turn those in, and so in an observation, you establish what it is you're looking for or what you're going to do. You set up a time if necessary. You take detailed notes. And so you'll notice that field research is a bit more formal than just casual, for example, observation. And then you analyze what you've seen. The final type of field research is a survey. And especially with a lot of tools that are available now, like I know some of the social media sites have survey tools. I think Facebook does. It used to be that people would have to type up surveys and distribute them. To give you an example, I had a student, she was a Marine, and she wanted to argue that female Marines should see frontline combat. I think at the time, I don't know what the guidelines are now, but at the time, that was not the case. And so she created a survey that she distributed to all of the people in her particular group, and then compiled the results, and then used those results. Okay, so there's also a great little tool online. I don't know if you're familiar with this. It's a free tool. It's surveymonkey.com. And we use it at administratively here at the school when we want to get feedback on meetings or that kind of thing. But a survey, you compile a list of questions. They're usually short. They're usually focused. You decide who your audience is. And obviously, for a survey to be accurate, you don't want to just give it to people who are going to agree with you, right? You want to distribute the information to people who, to get a sort of a broad sampling of responses. You design it, and then you analyze the results. Now, again, I'm not requiring that you use field research, but students who have time and who have the interest often find this to using field research to be a successful, useful part of their research process. I'm going to pause. Anybody have any questions about this? Okay, let's talk about the issue proposal. The issue proposal is a short document. It's only 25 points, okay? And it's very focused. I tell you exactly what to put in every paragraph, okay? The issue proposal is a brief document, 4 paragraphs with specific purposes. And I've already explained why I do it, so you can certainly go back and read through that. Remember that has to prove your topic. And what I'll do is, you submit your issue proposal, turn it in, I will read it, I will give you feedback, I'll give you the grade, and I'll, at the very top of the page, I'll say issue approved or whatever. Okay, so remember that it's roughly 350 to 400 words. It's a double space, so we're using the same format, the same header that we've used all semester. It should have a title, but you don't have to stick with the title if you don't like it. Paragraph number 1 should introduce the issue and then present it in question form. In other words, you start out by just like a normal introduction, and then it leads down to questions. Now, please understand, I've had students misunderstand this point and think every sentence should be a question in the introduction. No, it should just end with questions. Now, because I'm very specific about what I want in the issue proposal, I will count off if you don't follow this, all right? Paragraph 2 is the paragraph that explains why it's interesting. Why do you want to write about this? And this is personal. What about this topic compels you? Paragraph number 3 talks about what you already know. If it's nothing, that's what you say. I really know next to nothing about this topic. Paragraph number 4 should tell what you want to learn. This is kind of the research paragraph. This is, you don't actually do research here, but you explain, okay, when I do research, this is the kind of information I'm looking for. This is what I want to find out. Okay. Again, standard American English, which means that mid-level diction, okay? Now, the second page of your issue proposal is a sample. I got the student's permission. This is an actual student paper issue proposal. We're not going to read it out loud, but I want to show you again that this is a good sample to show you how the structure is supposed to look, okay? So you start out with the introduction. I never thought people with so much money could not buy their privacy. And then it leads down to questions. So the last, you know, three sentences or so actually have questions. By the way, I've had students ask me in the past, can I actually use my issue proposal and just lift parts of it and put it in my paper when you actually write the paper? Absolutely. If it fits and if it works, you may do so. Also, while I'm thinking about it, should you decide to change your topic, and remember that I always recommend that students have a backup topic in case the first one doesn't work, especially with research. If you change your topic, you don't have to do a new issue proposal. Just more informally email me about it, and we'll talk that way, okay? All right, second paragraph is the interest paragraph. Why are you interested? So notice that this student literally begins with, I am interested in this. And so then she gives background about why she cares. Third paragraph is what you know. So here she literally begins with the words, I know that. And the rest of this paragraph is about, you know, what she knows. And then the fourth paragraph is what I call the research paragraph. This is what you want to research, what she wants to find out. And with research, the best advice I can give you is to remain flexible, because you may want to find something, but that doesn't mean you're going to. That's one of the joys and the frustrations of good research, is that you may or may not, you know, find information that you really would like to. Okay, I'm going to pause there. Do you have any questions about the issue proposal? Okay, if not, I want to give you a few tips about finding a good topic. Okay, Kelly, am I going to provide this example? Let's see what your question was. Yes, the issue, what I just showed you, the sample student issue proposal, is on the, it's actually part, it's attached to the guidelines. The guidelines are already in week 11 folder, okay? And instead of making the issue proposal as the student sample a different document, it's just all one document, okay? That's actually how I had the file, so. Good question, thank you. All right, so when you're deciding on a topic or an issue, here's some things to ask yourself. Oops, and I'm going to try and type this correctly. Is this an issue that has not been resolved or settled? Occasionally, I've had students who wrote about things that, you know, are no longer current topics. It doesn't happen very often, but it's something to ask yourself. Is this issue debatable? This is an important one. Is there more than one side to the particular topic? I had a student who argued against human trafficking. The problem with that is, who's going to argue in favor of human trafficking? Can you see the issue there? So try and figure out what the opposite side would be. Now, there are issues within this whole broader category of human trafficking that are debatable. You can say the laws aren't strong enough. You can say certain countries are not doing enough. You can, you know, there are some debatable topics within there, but you want to make sure that the issue itself that you've selected has more than one view. It's not settled. This one's tricky. Are you willing to consider a position and modify your views? Oops. If you are not, this may not be a good topic for you, and here's the reason why. When you start doing your research, you may find that it takes you a different direction. If you're being really closed-minded about something, remember when we talked about evaluating sources, we discussed the necessity of, it doesn't mean you don't have a bias. We all do, or you wouldn't choose that particular topic, right? But you have to kind of hold it somewhat loosely. If you're unwilling to look at what the information actually says, then unfortunately, if the goal of argumentation is to convince people to agree with you, or at least to maybe consider your position, there's less of a chance if you're rigid that they will be able to, and you're right in that way, that they will be able to consider what you've said. Does that make sense? Now, obviously, this is not an information paper, right? You're not presenting both sides, and then at the very end in the conclusion, you take a side. That's an information paper, all right? You want to build an argument, but at this stage in the research process, you need to select a topic that you may find, once you get into the information, you're willing to look at something besides just those things that agree with you. Does that make sense? I hope this one's very hard to explain to students because most students think, argumentation is a form of persuasion, but it's not just expressing your opinion. Again, the goal is to try and change somebody's mind, try to get people to take action, with a call to action, or at least to get them to consider a different viewpoint. It's got a different purpose than purely just expressing your side of something. I can give you a great example using the same topic. I had a student who was absolutely against the legalization of marijuana until she did the research, and then she changed her mind. The paper that she read was actually in favor. And this was several years ago. And then I had a student who was absolutely in favor of legalizing marijuana until he did the research. And of course, they found, different sets of information, but because they were sort of open-minded in their approach, he wrote a paper that was absolutely opposed to the legalization of marijuana for a variety of reasons. So, just to give you some examples there. All right. Question number four. I'm not going to change that. Sufficiently engaged and interested to inspire your audience's interest. Obviously, you can choose your topic, and I do want you to choose something that you care about and that's interesting to you. But at the same time, let's leave it at that. Is this issue significant enough be worth an investment of time? We'll be working on this assignment for the remainder of the semester with a few smaller assignments that are sort of support kind of scattered throughout the remaining folders, but this is the primary thing we'll be working on. So you want to choose something that you care enough about. Final question we'll ask here. This one's personal. Is this a safe topic for you? I've had students who've written about topics that, because they were so personal, they cared deeply, deeply, but the topics themselves were not safe because they were too emotionally close to whatever the topic was, and I'm not gonna provide any examples, but just to say, one of two things happens when you deal with an issue before you're ready to actually significantly research it. The first one is that students are too emotional, and therefore they can't have any degree of objectivity when they look at what they've written. Because ultimately, this is a paper to be graded, right? Or the second is that they are so close to, that they emotionally back off from it, so the paper becomes very general and they avoid, you know, including specifics, and that too. And of course, this is not supposed to be written from first person, by the way. The only time the word I should appear in this final paper is if you are some authority or have some significant experience with the topic. Otherwise, I or I believe or I think should not appear in this paper at all. Does that make sense? Let your research do the talking for you. Okay, so I'm going to leave that there. Does anybody have any questions about these are considerations as you choose issues? If not, we're going to go on to how to find source material. Okay. Right. Okay. I had a little lag time there. Sorry. That took a minute for it to show up. I already introduced you to how to find information in Credo Reference, which is one of the databases in the GNTC library. Just a reminder, you can access the library through our Blackboard links on our homepage. But you can also go to the GNTC homepage, www.gntc.edu, and then under My Resources, select Library. And that too will take you to the library home screen. Now, our system has changed in the past, honestly, 6 months. We have gone to a system called Primo that actually houses articles and, you know, the library holdings as far as books and reference materials and ebooks and those kinds of things. I'm going to show you a couple of different ways to find information. The first thing, though, that I want to point out, some of you have struggled. For some reason, there is a firewall, I think, as you attempt to access the required reading for this week, that essay, Is College Worth It? And The Economist evidently cut it off at a certain point. That was the publication in which the article was published. And so I'm going to show you how to find the same article using Primo, okay? So the title of the article was, Is College Worth It? And you'll notice that there are several articles here. But the one that you want I think it's that one. Here we go. Is College Worth It? And then Higher Education. So it's number 8. If you select this, it will take you to their options here, and it says full text available. Select this. Yeah, select either any of them. We're going to select this first one, and it will actually open up the article for you. Here's the text right there. So this is the same thing. It's just located in a different place. I don't think that the person in charge of our online resource realized that we were going to encounter those types of problems with our links in the English 1101 reader. So anyway, here's a workaround, right, where you can actually get to that article as well. So I hope everybody, you know, you just Google the title. It's the 8th one. I mean, not Google, but use Primo for the title. It's the 8th one down. Any questions on that? Great. All right. Good deal. All right, so let me show you you can obviously use Primo. Okay. So I'm going to pick a topic like cyberbullying. I ran this through just a little bit before. And you can use Primo, and that's fine. Because again, it's just a gigantic sort of search engine through all of the holdings for our campus, what we have access to in the broader Georgia system. So I'm going to select cyberbullying and then, of course, the search tool. Now, nobody's going to argue in favor of cyberbullying, right? That's, again, I would have to define my terms there. But notice that I've got 9,951 results. Sorry, I got my number wrong there. Okay, there are the results. That's too many. So I want to start narrowing this down because what most of us do as researchers, right, is we'll stop with the first few that we see. And notice that the first few that we see here are all books. Now, the problem with books is you don't have time to read them. Probably for this assignment, what you really want to look for more are journal articles, newspaper articles. So let's, here on the left-hand side of the screen, I can begin to narrow down the types of information I want. So notice that as I, you know, move my cursor over next to these, a little box appears. And so I'm going to check peer-reviewed journals. Actually, it doesn't have to be peer-reviewed. I'm going to pick articles. I want articles. Location doesn't matter because I want information that's located in databases or on the web. I'm not interested in, you know, what's on what campus. I'm not even going to narrow down necessarily the subjects, but I do want to narrow down the dates, creation date, because notice how old that is. So I'm going to change this from, let's just say, I want the latest information, so in the last 5 years. So I'm going to change it from 2015 to 2020. Because if you think about it, okay, information published in 2010 even about cyberbullying is probably outdated now. As rapidly as things change in our culture, and especially online, we've got newer, better, greater techniques and information, right? So I'm going to select that. And then here at the bottom, I'm going to select Apply Filters. So you see this green box. And that's narrowed down to, at least I'm down to 45,000, okay? Now, one of the things you want to look for is you want to find information that says full text available. This is important because some of these topics, some of these articles, it may just have the summary, okay? It may not be the complete article, or you may not be able to access it for some other reason. You have to pay for it, for example, which you don't want to do. So you want to select the full text. Now, I'm going to read through here. Let's just say, is cyberbullying worse than traditional bullying? Sometimes you can tell from the titles that the language is too elevated. And remember when we studied diction and that formal level, it's written by experts in the language of experts. And so probably I want to read things that I'm able to understand. Okay. So you can also look and see how many pages, because if the article is too long, you may not be interested in that. But let's just take this one. I'm going to select full text available. All right. And then again, you have options. So I'm going to select the first one here. Now, an abstract is another term for a summary. Never, ever, 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 ever quote from an abstract. You need to go to the full article itself. But one of the things that the abstract will show you is whether or not the information is something that's accessible. I don't understand this language, all right? Has been considered as being worse than traditional. The difference is mainly attributed to various, that part's okay. But then we get down to anonymity and perceived severity. You're choosing as a topic. Okay, let's see what you said, Kelly. There is some very wordy stuff. Just the way I speak is like that. It's how I understand things. What do I do? If I'm your audience for this paper, if you if you don't write things in a way that I, as a lay person, can understand it, then you haven't met that requirement. So what that means is, okay, you may understand this, how this is written, but for me, you're going to have to translate your terms. You have to explain your terms. Remember in the diction section, we talked about jargon. That's exactly what we're addressing here. If they're IT terms and techie terms, if I can't understand it, then I can't really, and I'm your audience, then you haven't successfully communicated with me. Does that make sense? So you've got to write it in such a way, sort of translate the information in such a way that I understand it. Does that make, and that goes for anybody choosing a technical topic. Okay. Now, if you don't think that you can translate information well, we're very early in this process, you might want to select a different topic. I mean, to be honest. Because again, it's a different thing if you were writing, if you're taking an IT class, and your audience are people who already, you speak the same language, right? Then you don't have to explain anything, you know, unless there are concepts that are unfamiliar to them. But for me, you've got to break it down and explain it. Okay. Does everybody kind of understand that? That has to do with audience and understanding your audience and using language that your audience can understand. I hope that makes sense. Okay, but we're going to stay with this article for just a second. There are two other things I want to show you and we'll be done. The main thing is, let's say you read this article, you find some information, and I'm not requiring that you turn in notes, but I do strongly recommend students take notes from what they read. I realize, though, for many students, it's easier now to just print or even literally underline things as they go. And you want to be careful, though. No more than 20% of your paper should be directly quoted. The rest of your information should be either paraphrased or summarized, all right? And I turn it in, we'll show you that. And that's the last thing I'm going to show you before we're done. But here in the upper right-hand corner, you can download the PDF version of this and save it, and then even print a hard copy. Cite, you can email it to yourself, you can print it. Cite, the great thing about this is it shows you how to actually, it actually does the citation for you. So all you have to do is copy and paste. All right, highlight, control C, or right click and copy, and then paste that right into, in this case, you know, you're going to be doing an annotated bibliography for me. Just paste it right into that page. Or here it says you can copy it. I guess it copies directly. So it copies to clipboard, and then you paste it on a page. All right. So congratulations. And notice, you know, you can change it if you were doing a paper for a different class and they required a different form of documentation, Harvard style, MLA style, Turabian, and so forth. You just select whichever version. We're, of course, using the APA style. All right. So handy dandy. Another good reason for using the database material, A, you don't have to evaluate to determine how credible the source material is. B, it does the citation for you. All right, any questions on this? I want to show you one last thing, two more things, and then we're done. Okay. If you don't want to use Primo, you can certainly use the databases. There's an option here, databases A to Z. And I want to make you aware, especially if you're struggling to come up with a topic, there is this wonderful resource called Facts on File, Issues and Controversies. And what the resource does is it takes all of these different topics and it presents both sides of the issue. It doesn't take a stand either way. It just presents the pros and the cons of both sides of an issue. And so if you're having trouble struggling to even find a topic, notice that it's got them broken down into categories. So society, culture, and religion. And then they're alphabetized and they're 81 issues in all just in this category. Okay. So this can help you, like, if you just look through here, give you some ideas some possible ideas. But also, this is a wonderful resource for actually finding information. So let's see if I've got my cyberbullying topic here somewhere. I can't remember where I found it. Science. There it is. Cybersecurity. Well, let's just go with cybercrime. I hear the actual articles, pro-con articles. Should cyberbullies be prosecuted? Notice that it summarizes the supporter side and it summarizes the opponent side. If you click on the title itself, it opens, and this is an entire, very readable report that explores both sides. Okay? It's got graphs, it's got charts. And the really wonderful thing about Facts on File, at the very end, it's a secondary document compiled from these primary sources, all right? So now you can find additional articles here that you can look up online, and those can be some of your sources as well. Now, some of the information here is old, so you want to see when it was last updated. This one's recent, December 3rd, 2019. And remember, in evaluating sources, you want to use current material for most of the issues that you choose, unless you want to sort of look at the history of an issue. But otherwise, you want something, I would think, published in the last 5 years, just depending on your topics, okay? Currency, remember, was one of the five criteria for evaluating sources. Now, you don't want to build an entire paper just from Facts on File articles. They're wonderful, but that's a no. I want you to get a broader experience with the research process than just this, but this is a wonderful tool. The downside is that it doesn't offer you an APA formatted citation, but you should know enough about APA citations to know how to take, it uses MLA, that's what it provides here. You should know enough about APA documentation style to be able to take this and just rearrange the information. So remember that in this case, the article title would come first. You just take off the quotation marks. You only capitalize the first word. You only capitalize the first word after a colon, and then lowercase cyberbully, lowercase b, lowercase prosecute. Next is the date of publication, which in this case is December 3rd. So you'd put this here in parentheses, then issues and controversies, then a period, then retrieved. Remember your retrieval information, and then you just copy this web address, retrieved, you know, this date from this web address. So you should know enough to be able to take this format and turn it around and make it an APA format. Does that make sense? I hope, everyone. Okay. So this is a wonderful resource. Also remember, Credo Reference is a good starting place, especially to define your terms. I'm not requiring that you use it, and you definitely don't want to build a whole paper just from a reference database, but it's a good starting place. Okay. Reminder not to use Wikipedia. The only benefit of Wikipedia, there are two actually, you can get good search terms from Wikipedia that you can then use to go and look up other information. And often at the end of Wikipedia articles, there are a list of references, right, that you can actually go and look up as well if they look to be credible sources. Any questions on this? All right, last thing I want to show you. This is a student paper from last semester. And remember that I said no more than 20% of your paper should be directly quoted. Everything else should be either paraphrased or summarized, written in your own words, still documented, right? Because you did, if you don't know the information before you read it, you need to give your source credit. But Turnitin actually will help you understand, make sure that you're handling your information right. So notice here in the red, and I think I've showed you this before, but just a reminder, 15% of this paper Turnitin has identified as being directly quoted, as long as it's handled correctly. If it's not, it becomes plagiarized, right? So if you select the 15, what it does is show you all of the different places, papers or student papers or articles where it found source material. And as you scroll through this paper, you'll notice that it highlights and it gives the number, and the number corresponds over here to, you know, whatever the source is. As long as the student has quotation marks around the information and documents it, it is said that, and she put her documentation here, and she didn't need the first initial, of course, but it's got quotation marks, and this is correctly handled, right? So is this. So this is a way you can check your own paper to make sure that you're not unintentionally plagiarizing, and that you've got, you're at 20% or less of directly quoted information. More than 20%, there's too much of other people talking, so your paper becomes choppy. But please hear me, I'm not saying that it needs to be 0%. Direct quotations are important. They emphasize a point. If you're using somebody who's an authority, you want them to be, to let them speak, to let them do the talking. They sometimes are so beautifully worded that, you know, if you try to put the information in your own words, it's not effective. So they're very important. Please understand that. But I'm just saying, use it to make sure that you are meeting that threshold of 20% or less direct quotation. All right, I'm going to stop there. We're at about an hour. Does anyone have any questions about any of this for me? All right. Well, thanks so much. I'm glad you joined me. Have a good rest of the afternoon. And should anything arise in the next few days, just email me. But please get your issue proposals in as soon as possible, and I will look at them and give you feedback so you can get started on this assignment. All righty. Have a good afternoon.